animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Hello and welcome on another African Bush extravaganza, where the mysteries of the wild are just waiting to be unfolded. This is Safari Live. And a very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome on an extended sunset safari. My name is Jamie. This afternoon I have Dave on camera with me, and we are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa, which means that there's all kinds of exciting animals, from leopards, lions, elephants and everything in between. Now, not only are we live, but we are also interactive, which means that you can send through your questions on hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And please do let us know if you're joining us for the first time, and if you... Come on, Rusty. Up the hill you go. Rusty's the car, by the way, if you are joining us for the first time. Now, please do let us know if you are joining us, because we've got all kinds of exciting things planned for you. And as I said, it will be an extended safari where we will be using infrared in the situations where we might otherwise not be able to view the animals at night. So very, very exciting times. Even more exciting is the fact that Brent Smith is back from holidays, is out on Wendy, which is the other car, with Zunder. And of course, the inimitable Mr. James Hendry is an expert. And there was extraordinary... So incredible scenes seen yesterday on the sunset safari. We're slowly trundling our way because, of course, the wonderful Herbie, who is our tracker, thoroughly dependent on. I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. It sounds like they're moving. We'd better hurry up then. What are you doing, lions? It's hot. Slowly trundling our way because, of course, the wonderful Herbie, who is our tracker, thoroughly dependent on. I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. It sounds like they're moving. We'd better hurry up then. What are you doing, lions? It's hot. Slowly trundling our way because, of course, the wonderful Herbie, who is our tracker, thoroughly dependent on. I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel. It sounds like they're moving. We'd better hurry up then. What are you doing, lions? It's hot.
Sorry about this, everybody. Perhaps something has pushed over the gauri repeater, just like the elephants have pushed over this marula tree. Our technical team is rushing around madly trying to fix it, and we'll be back with you as soon as we can.
And welcome back to all of you that... Oh, whoopsie. Sorry about that. And take those off. I was taking the opportunity to shelter my eyes ever so briefly since we're on our way to our lion sighting. And I do apologize for those of you that missed out on it and went to Tech Loop. As you know, bringing you a live safari from the center of the African bush can come with certain complications, but we are back up and running. Our word on the street is we know who the culprit was that time, but I'm not a snitch. I'm not going to tell on anybody. Let's go look for those lions instead. Okay, so if my calculations are correct, we should be popping in somewhere here, and perhaps you'll even be treated to the magic that is Herbie's smile. Oh, Dacre. Those of you who haven't met Herbie, you are in for a serious treat. That was a little Dacre, by the way, dashing off away from the lions. I think feeling particularly grateful that it managed to remain off the menu. Okay. Back to the Nkuhuma's house. That's what I've decided. We should rename the gauri cutline the Nkuhuma house, because that's where they seem to live all of the time, unless they're in Buffalo's Hook. Everybody, watch your heads. Okay, well, we shuffle forward to get a view of these lions. Let's head across to Brent, who I'm sure is very, very excited to say hello to you after his extended break.
Hello and welcome to the Mawati River. And in the words of the late, great Lou Reed, let's take a walk on the wild side. So we're looking for all animals we can find down here. I was hoping to find some leopard tracks. I'm also in search of that elusive white-throated robin that keeps avoiding me. But I'm just checking carefully, see if Karula's come across. I heard she hasn't been seen in a few days. Hopefully we'll get some luck. If not, we're going to head east down towards the now bright green of Cheetah Plains. And what a difference a week makes. When I left, there was not a blade of grass hither or nither. Now they are everywhere. And isn't that glorious? I'm sure there's some very happy wildebeest and zebra around. Now, of course, those of you who have been watching for a long time will know I am very fond of flowers. And I've got a tricky flower to start off the drive. Ha ha. Ha ha. There we go. There is a flower. Now, if we look carefully, if I turn it, you can actually see very, very delicate little individual flowers. Lovely aroma to them. And I wonder if anyone out there knows where this flower comes from. It is a tricky one. I decided no fanning about. We're going to get right into it. Get you started with a really difficult quiz. So if you know where this flower comes from, you can send the answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Yes, we are live. If none of you believe me, send me an email or send me a question on Twitter and I'll hopefully be able to have all the answers for you. If not, we've got James and Jamie, who are much smarter than me, so maybe they'll have the answers. But we're going to keep moving down the riverbed. No sign of any kitty cats so far, but it is lovely to be back and back with a bit of a green flush around. Now, of course, this white-throated robin malarkey has been carrying on for quite some time. We've only ever got them on camera once, right here, and they taunt me every morning. But I also heard a class's cuckoo on my way down the drainage line, so me and some of the cuckoo species are going to be back, And that means maybe soon we'll be able to get that elusive 50 birds in one drive. Well, now we're out of the shade of the large jackalberries. Time to put my Stogo back on. And of course, Stogo is Zulu for a hat. Just in case you were wondering. And that is exactly where Eggsy gets his name, and that's who's on camera with me today, Zander, also better known as Eggsy. And his, I don't know how James quite got to it, but Zander's obviously spelled with an X, and Matanda is a egg in Zulu, but also with an X. Zander, is it from your name or your bald head? Both, there we go. Always good to check these clay walls, especially now that the birds are going to start breeding. I want to see if any of my known little spots have had any excavation or showing any droppings. Now, there was a grey hooded kingfisher that was nesting in that highest hole there last wet season, but as you can see, there's no sign of you can see there's no sign of fresh excavation or fresh droppings. So we will be keeping a lookout. Now that is one of the more rare bird species we see in this part of the world. Now of course the European beaters are also on their way. And last I heard they were passing James. From my updates from my friends up there, I heard, oh, there we go. Oh, wasn't that lucky? Well, no kitty cats in the Mawati, but one of my other favorite creatures. And there's a little one. So a nice little breeding herd of elephants up ahead. Just gonna get past where the elephants live. Now, they will also be very happy with it. There's a bit of a green flash. Now, of course, normally during the summer months, 80% of an elephant's diet is made up of grass. Oh, and it looks like they've been having a ball in Twin Dams, covered in mud. There we go. There's a little sub-adult there. And of course there's a little one. You can see completely covered in mud all over its little bottom. Now of course with all the water around, the elephants have been having a jolly good time, I'm sure, as it heats up, spraying mud on themselves to cool down. Oh, we can hear them talking to each other. Hello, Mum. How are you today? You're looking very relaxed. Much happier that there's been a bit of water around. Oh, and we're getting charged. Yes, you are a very scary little man. Now, don't get too far away from your mum. That would be truly scary. So we've got one answer in for the very tricky flower, and so far no one's got it. Bride's bush is incorrect. It is tricky because it is a flower, but it comes from a tree. There we go, there's another hint. Let's go have a look at these eddies up ahead. And if I'm really going to give it away. If we look carefully to the left, that is the tree that this... Oh, not too far. This one closest here. There we go. This is the tree that the flower comes from. Hi, Janet. Janet says, welcome back. Thanks, Janet. Great to be back. It is not a Vinonia. As I said, I cheated a little bit. Once this elephant walks past, I'll show you what I mean. And you might get it a little bit quicker once you see the rest of the tree. I was being mean. Now, okay, if we have a look right next to us here, Eggsy, you'll see lots of flowers. But the giveaway is the fruit. So you'll see that dark red fruit. There we go. A little bit to the right. There we go. There's some fruit there. Now, hopefully, that lovely color will give you a hint to what tree that this flower belongs to. But while I leave these elephants as they move off into the thickets, we're going to head towards Cheetah Plains. And while we do that, let's go back to Jamie and those glorious Inkahumas.
Not 100% true that there are no cats in the Mawati, because our pride of lions is here just outside of the Mawati drainage line, right up north. And look at that. The whole Inkahuma family having a really peaceful afternoon. Well, the reason we're sitting where we are and we're sitting so far away from them is that when I came in, I noticed that their heads were up immediately. There was a very significant change in their body language. And who knows what might have happened. It might have just been that they were a little bit startled by a herd of elephants or something like that. But either way, it's an important reminder that no matter how much time we spend with our wonderful animals, we always treat them each new day as a different day, and always remember that they are completely wild. So what I'm doing is I'm sitting quite far away from them for now and just waiting for them, talking my normal voice, just waiting for them to get a little bit more used to the idea of us being here. So something frightened them. It's not us. It's not a vehicle, because as you know, the Inkahumas are very, very comfortable with vehicles. But you can see, look, you can see it in their body language that they're not asleep. They're up, their heads are up, they keep glancing off in the southerly direction. So something startled them. And we've just got to let them relax a little bit before we get any closer. And because it's quite dense vegetation, I mean, I have to maneuver the vehicle around a little bit when we do go in. So we'll just do that slowly, increment by increment. Oh, shame. Look at the lioness at the back. She's snarling, not at us, but because the little cubs are still suckling, but with their very sharp teeth and their very sharp claws, look, you can see a paw smacking her in the belly there. They're hurting her, and it's not very comfortable for her. Nevertheless, we have exciting prospects for this afternoon. The Inkahumas are going to be hungry. Doesn't look as though they've eaten since last night when we saw them. So they're going to be on the hunt this evening, probably leaving their precious little bundles behind, since nothing can be more detrimental to a lioness hunting than having bumbling cubs ruining everything, either letting the animals know that they're there or getting in the way, making a noise, all in all just generally being a little bit of a pain. So they'll probably leave the cubs at the start of this evening and head off hunting. And I can't wait for James to return so that we can chat a little bit about the comparison between the Mara lions and our Sabi sand lions. The differences and the similarities, because there will be differences and similarities. Oh, such an exhausted lioness. So there should be 8 cubs here. Impossible for us to do a head count. I don't even know how many lionesses are here. There's definitely 3. But I don't know if all 5 are present, or if 1 or 2 of them are separate from the group. All in all, a really lovely way to start off an afternoon. Here we go, everybody's relaxing a little bit. Okay, we're going to try sneaking closer, Not even a word. We're going to try sneaking closer, bit by bit. In the meantime, let's head all the way back across to the Mara so that you can chat to James yourself.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome, of course, to the Mara Triangle for this, the final installment of the September Mara Spectacular with Safari Live. My name is James Hendry, in case you didn't know, on camera today, Jean-Dre. He is not going to show you his grubby thumb because it is under... Oh, it is! Look at that!
Washed it.
He washed it, very nice. He's about to wash it again, of course, in the rain. As you can see, it is coming in from the eastern side of this magnificent reserve. In fact, it is already falling in the southeast, it would seem. This is unaffected, or it has not affected the zebra and the wildebeest over here. And we've just stopped at this point so that we could give you a bit of a view of the great diversity, the scenery, the rain coming in, and tell you that there haven't been any crossings today that we've managed to find. We've been to the main points that we went to yesterday, where we saw all that astounding action. And then off to this side is the last crossing point we're going to go and have a look at, and we'll see what happens there. Then... the lions. We've had some interesting lion stuff going on during the course of the day. We found two new lions we haven't seen before. They seem to be quite interested in hunting fairly soon. So with any luck, we'll follow them at night. I think that's going to be our best bet. The Kichwa Tembo Pride, who we saw yesterday, fast asleep. They still seem to be fast asleep and most satiated. And then we met a new seven lions recently. They were off sort of underneath where it's just started to rain over there, and they are not doing very much at all because they, like most of the other cats in this area, have eaten themselves into a Sunday lunch stupor, even though it's Saturday. It is Saturday, isn't it? Yes, it is indeed. Then we've got some buffalo off to the right-hand side of where you're now looking. But mostly, before we go and look at the buffalo, we're going to show you Graham Wallington's very favourite animal. That is the topi. There is one topi in front of us there. Well, it was. It is now behind a large vehicle. Oh, well, that is disappointing.
Told you that was a bear.
Oh, Graham, there it is, go. Super zoom that topi, Jean-Dre. There it is. Oh, look at that. I think these things are amazing. And there are subspecies of the sesame, which we do find in the Kruger from time to time. Lots of them in the Okavango in Botswana. The sesame, that is. And the topi up here, very fascinating, mainly because nobody really understands its social structure. It's apparently got one of the most variable social structure of all the antelope species. Sometimes a harem situation, sometimes they move in great herds, sometimes with the migration, often they're resident here. It's really rather fascinating. So I'd like to spend some more time with topi. Unfortunately, Graham Wallington, who of course, as you all know, is responsible for my employment, he thinks topi are, well, not quite as exciting as some of the other things that we have on offer here in the Mara Triangle. And as he's sitting in the back of the car, well, we must just do what he says. Joey, you want to see an eland, and you say, is this the last opportunity? Well, it might be the last opportunity for this particular time, but we've actually got an eland in front of us, spotted very kindly by Tyler, who is the general manager of Angama Mara, where we're staying, quite possibly the most beautiful lodge in the world. I cannot see the eland, however. Tyler is an American, so his eyes are better designed than mine, I think.
Straight up the road.
Ah, got it on the ridge there. There you go, Joey. There's an eland, courtesy of Tyler. Isn't that lovely? Now, they inhabit the ecotone regions. That's where you see it there. An ecotone, the sort of gap, if you like, between, or the place where two vegetation types meet. So they're like the woodland where it moves into the grassland. And you will see them, obviously, moving across the grasslands. But those eland are sitting in the ecotone. Aren't they gorgeous? Thanks for that, Joey. That is the continent's biggest antelope. I think the Lord Derby's, which you can find in Queen Elizabeth Park in Uganda, is slightly bigger than this one. And that's, I think it's just a subspecies of this eland. Aren't they lovely? Eland, I suppose, is what I should be saying. Eland is the Afrikaans pronunciation. I got shouted at that by Mr. Graham Wallington yesterday evening, lest I be hauled in front of a disciplinary commission, I better say it correctly, Eland. And the big bull weighs up to 750 kilograms, which is round about 1,800 pounds, which, of course, is many pounds in anyone's language. Now, let us drive a little bit, Jandry. Is that okay with you?
Quite so.
He says, quite so. It's very nice that he's actually speaking today. Sometimes he doesn't speak at all. Well, I mean, look, when we're not live, that's a benefit. But when we're live, it's nice to hear from him every so often. Not too much, though. Okay, you can see that it is still an absolutely beautiful landscape just because it is in East Africa and because everywhere you look, it's stunning. Sandy, you'd want to know if we've seen the baby Thompson's gazelle that we saw crossing the river yesterday today. No, not as far as I know, Sandy. I just need to give you an idea, Sandy. My camera is on the roof. Thank you very much for that, Rebecca. What an idiot. Not Rebecca, me, I mean. Let's go with this again. Sandy, the area we're driving is so vast. It's so much bigger. It's the size of the entire Sabi Sand. So for us to find the individual Thompson's gazelle fawn or lamb that came out of the river yesterday would be almost impossible. This was the area, though, that it was in. But I think, Sandy, that it either joined up with a herd and is fine, or it has been devoured by a predator during the night. It would be very difficult to say, even if we saw one the same size, whether or not it was the same one. There are the eland, Joey in Australia. There's a lovely view of them for you, sitting on this rocky knoll where there's some trees. You can see them browsing there. So they're quite adept mixed feeders, are the eland. Clearly able to browse and graze. They look to be in, well, relatively good nick. That one looks a little bit skinny, a bit hippie. But they are stunning. And quite adaptable, you know. They live in this area, which is fairly well watered. You can find them all the way into the Kalahari in southern Africa, which is, well, it is a desert, semi-desert to desert. And they survive there very well. This is our first proper eland sighting. Very nice. Okay, let's move on. There's just a little, the crossing is just down the way here. And we'll just have a quick look at it and see if we can't find some of those gormless crocodiles. While we drive along here, let me share you some of my impressions of the crocodilians here. It is my firm impression that a crocodile is one of nature's most dim-witted creatures, having seen what they do during the course of the day. Yesterday we watched one raised its head out of the water before any animals had got into the water. There were wildebeest and zebra massing to come across the river, and this idiot stuck his head out of the water and they all ran away and then crossed unscathed at another crossing point. Then the day before that, we watched a crocodile lying exactly where I'm going to take you now, also in front of a herd of wildebeest on the sand with his mouth open facing him, as if to say to his lunch, please run into my mouth. Needless to say, not even the wildebeest, which is supposedly renowned as one of the most gormless creatures in Africa, not even the wildebeest would fall for a trick like that. It is a little bit rattly, I apologize for that. Like I've said before, the vehicle we are driving is, it makes Wendy, Rusty and Jigger look like utterly youthful and wonderful animals. Right, we're just going to quickly pop down to this crossing here, and if there's nothing, well, if there's something there, we'll come back to you. If there isn't, we'll find something else. So let's head across back to the Nkohuma Pride with Jamie Patterson, and we'll catch up with you shortly.
We've shuffled a little bit closer to the Nkohuma Pride. As you can see, they are now perfectly relaxed. Heads down, everybody is very fast asleep. And there's some hungry looking bellies there. I think that the females are slowly going to stop lactating over the next few weeks, and the cubs are going to be entirely reliant upon the meat that their mothers manage to catch. And as a result, they will start to look a little bit hungry, and cubs do go through the stage, so don't get distressed as you watch us over the next few weeks. Lion cubs go through a phase where they start to look really lanky and quite thin, and that's almost like that teenager phase where they're doing so much growing. That doesn't mean that they're not getting the nutrients they need. They just grow so fast that their bodies can't keep up with them, and it takes them a while to fill out. But they go through a stage where they look not unhealthy, but they really do look lanky with their massive paws. I can't wait. I'm so excited to get to watch these little cubs grow up, to see the males start to get their manes. They get that fluffy fuzz all around their faces, like a sort of a teenage boy growing a beard. Oh, it's so exciting. My absolute favorite. I was just commenting to Dave that no matter how much time we spend with these lions, and we've been lucky. We've spent a considerable period of time. We've been fortunate enough in that they have chosen to spend most of their time on Juma, where their territory extends all the way towards the Manuleti, into Arethusa, Elephant Plains, Simbambili, Torchwood. We've just been so incredibly fortunate that they've chosen this place as the center of their territory and the place that they've chosen to raise their cubs. And no matter how much time we spend with them, it never gets old. They never get boring. They're always up to something new and exciting and interesting. And this is a privilege that is, well, pretty much unbeatable, to spend the amount of time and to follow lion cubs basically from birth as they grow up. And really, you can't match that. Hey, little lions, do you think we can get a bit closer? Not yet. I don't think so, not yet. I can only count three females at the moment, so I think all three moms are here. As to where Amber Eyes and the young female are, I have absolutely no idea. And I know that Herbert is hard at work trying to see if he can't track them down. And he did also tell me that there is a buffalo, or a group of buffalo bulls, not too far away from where we are. And I think that's one of the reasons why the Nkumas have been camping out here. It's such a perfect ambush spot. You can see how hidden they are, behind the Tamburti trees in the thicket. And they've just been waiting for animals to come stumbling unaware into their midst. And that female still keeps sitting up. I'm going to wait. Before I reposition, I'm going to wait until her head is down, almost down completely. Oh, look at them. They're growing up so fast. That's got to be one of the oldest cubs at the back. It'll be so much fun watching them develop their individual personalities as well. The little unique aspects of them that will differentiate one from the other. Although, I'm going to advise you, and I'm not going to advise you, I'm actually going to ask you to please help me over the next few days and the more time we spend with the Nkuhumas. For our regular viewers, let's start building up a database. And I'm going to do it when we can get a bit closer. We can't do it now. But when we get a little bit closer, if we can start building up a database of the individual cubs, left, right, and straight on, their whisker spot patterns, and males, females, which litter they come from. They all come from the same generation. But which litter they come from, we can actually build up a nice little collage that we'll be able to compare with later as the cubs start to grow older. I think that'll be a really nice idea. Now, Tracy, on the subject of our lactating females and the hungry patch that the little cubs go through, you want to know how long do they wean for and will they be left to fend for themselves when they are weaned. Let's start with the second question first. They won't be left for to fend for themselves. The females will look after them until they are roughly 2 years old, for the most part. So the lionesses will do the bulk of the hunting. When they get to about a year and a half, closer to two, then they start to meaningfully contribute to the hunting success of the pride. And then in terms of weaning, they'll all be weaned by about 6 months of age. The older cubs are lucky in that the mother of the younger cubs, or the youngest generation, will obviously lactate for longer than their own mother, which means that they'll actually have a chance, because lionesses allosuckle, they'll actually have a chance to feed for a little bit longer than they might if they were just on their own, if it was just their mother feeding them. So in that way they actually are fortunate to be the oldest set of cubs, and they will fight off the younger cubs to get a chance to suckle. But by about 6 months of age, all of the females should have stopped lactating, and the little cubs will be on a pure meat-based diet. And that is also when they times perfectly with their growth spurts, which is why they do look a little bit thin, or go through that stage of looking a little bit thin. The nice thing about today, although it is hot, it's 31 degrees, which is 88. There is some cloud cover, which means the lionesses could be active much earlier than they might otherwise be. Wingnut, speaking of hunting and the cubs and where they get to go, you want to know how they know when to stay and when to go with the lionesses. I often wonder that. I've also wondered that with leopards as well. Obviously, there's something that is communicated to them, and I suppose it makes sense. Lions can talk to each other just as we can talk to each other. Just as human beings, we haven't quite fully developed our understanding of what they're saying. Often the females will walk away and give a contact call, a soft ooh, ooh sound. It's very, very soft, so as not to draw attention to herself and her cubs. And as she makes that soft contact call, then obviously the cubs know that they can come with her. And I have seen leopards aggressively discourage their cubs from following them. When the cub hasn't listened, I've seen them turn around and snarl at them and bat them about a bit, almost like an errant child being disciplined by the female. I haven't seen lions do that, but I wouldn't be surprised if that's behavior that carries across the large cat species, where they make their intentions known in a very indisputable manner. Just by the way, while we're sitting here, this is a perfect bird watching spot. They haven't come into view yet, but I'm hoping while we sit here, for those of you that are keen birders and want a screenshot of a chin spot battus, I'm really hoping that at some point they're going to stop making a fuss as far into the drainage line as they are. You can hear them chirping away merrily. I'm hoping that they're going to come out a little bit closer and give us a view of them. There's also some shrikes calling. We could see all kinds of things while we sit here and enjoy, oh cute, a little bit of time spent with the cubs. Don't you love the spotted bellies? Too gorgeous. Oh, ho, ho. And that, of course, those spots will pretty much disappear as they start to grow older. It's a nice way of camouflaging them when they are young and vulnerable and left all alone. Up we get. Oh, look at you. Okay, down we go again. Just giving us a tantalizing glimpse of those huge, curious eyes that they have. Must be a nice life being a lion cub, all sheltered and protected. And hollows, I can almost guarantee that the brothers of this group will stay together as the Birminghams did. I think that's exactly what they're going to do. They're going to stick together and form a coalition. And they're fortunate in that there's at least three of them, from what we can tell. So there's three males and five females. The females will stay with the pride, but the males will leave together, I think. And don't forget, of course, whoopsie, that wasn't very coordinated. What's the matter, little cub? Don't forget that Amber Eyes and the young female could still have cubs. And although they will be probably about 6 months apart from the youngest set of these cubs, they could contain males as well. The Birmingham boys, there's about a year age gap between the eldest and the youngest. Flop. Sorry guys, I just have to listen to the Game Drive channel. As you can imagine, there are quite a few people that are keen on seeing these lion cubs. so I just need to chat to them quickly. Abel, I'll keep you guys updated. For now, they're sort of in the Tamburti thicket. It's quite difficult to get a mover in here. Copy that, no problem. So just updating everybody that if they want to come and bring their guests, that it's going to be quite a tricky spot for them to get into, especially with the cubs not being terribly relaxed, although I have to say they're now looking a great deal better. I'm just going to, bear with me, you might hear some funny sounds. I'm just going to readjust my microphone that is playing games with me, so sorry for the funny sounds. Now, Katie, who is 6 years old, you wanted to know, where are the daddy lions? Well, Katie, the daddy lions, when it comes to lions, daddy lions actually don't really play a big role in looking after the cubs. Well, they do, but they're not hands-on dads. What they have to do in order to keep the cubs safe and to be good daddy lions is to patrol an enormous territory to make sure that no other strange male lions come into their territory. So the daddy lions are probably off patrolling, making sure that their territory, every other lion in this area knows that this is their land and that they mustn't come in and chase the little baby cubs away. So that's where the daddy lions are. They might also be off with some of the other females, because daddy lions will spend a bit of time with different groups of lions. With the Birmingham boys, it's the Sticks and the Nkuhumas, those are their prides, but they might be spending time with other ladies somewhere else, and perhaps creating or making a new set of cubs to come and join these little ones. So sometimes we see the daddy lions here, and they're very good daddies. They're very tolerant. They let the cubs climb all over them, bite their ears and their tails, and they never hurt them. Sometimes they might give them a fatherly smack, but it's always very, very gentle. So the daddy lions aren't here at the moment, but you might see them. They might even come this evening as it starts to get dark. Such a peaceful scene, and such a contrast to where we were last year this time. Michael raises a very good point, and that is the fact that the Birmingham boys are actually not quite in their pride, in their prime, in that they are only 5 to 6 years old. And lions, male lions, do reach their prime at around 7 or 8 years old, possibly even older, depending upon where you are. And Michael wants to know, is there's a strong possibility when the female cubs reach sexual maturity that the males might mate with their daughters? That is standard lion behavior. It does happen, and generally lion genetics seem to be quite resilient to that sort of inbreeding. It's only after about 6 generations of inbreeding that you start to see major negative effects. But it is one of the big reasons why males' tenure is so short. And out here in the Sabi Sand and the Greater Kruger National Park area, to be honest, Michael, there are so many male lions waiting in the wings that the chances are relatively slim that will happen. We of course have got a hope, as we do because we're invested in these cubs, we've got a hope that the Birmingham boys stay in control until the little ones are about 2 years old, at which point another male coalition most likely will come through. There are always young males, there are young males that we don't even know about wandering through Kruger. There are coalitions that we're not even aware of. And the Birmingham boys came all the way from close to Birmingham Farm, which is a massive distance from where we are now. And there's plenty of coalitions of young males that will do the same. I think it's unlikely, but it is a possibility. It is what male lions do. If the opportunity is there, if the opportunity presents itself, they will mate with their daughters. And the same goes for male lions mating with their mothers or their sisters, if they're given the opportunity. Fortunately, though, with the Birmingham boys in control of this pride, chances are these young males will not be presented with that opportunity. We started to see that behaviour from Junior. Junior was the young Nkuhuma male. He'd reached sexual maturity and he was starting to show interest in the females of the pride, which of course would have been his mother and his aunts, and possibly even his sisters, older sisters. Now, they're not, of course, governed by the same rules that human beings are. As I said, fortunately, lion genetics particularly resilient to that level of inbreeding. Leopards will do it too. All of the big cats will. Generally, hyenas don't, interestingly enough, from what I've read. It's quite unusual in hyena clans to have that level of inbreeding. Very, very rare. Right, I think we can try this. I do think we can try a reposition. I've just got to figure out how I'm going to do it. Let's try. Get slowly but surely a bit closer. And I have a destination in mind. I'm just going to let the engine run for a little bit. The good thing is the females haven't even lifted their heads. And if they show any signs of discomfort, then we'll stop immediately. But we know the Nkuhumas. We know that they are relatively comfortable with vehicles. Okay. All heads have gone back down again. And let's back Darby into a thorn bush. Sorry, Darby. There we go. Hello, little ones. Much better. Much, much better. Yes. Here we go. Four females. Hello. There we go. A much better view of our Nkuhuma cubs. We're going to sit here and watch as they start to get active as the afternoon cools down. Let's head all the way back to the Mara, find out what James is up to this time.
Now everybody, what you can hear is the pitter-patter of African rain just before the storm really does a dump on us. But while we're watching this, that is a defasser waterbuck that you're looking at. You can see its bottom is fully white as opposed to just circularly white like the ones back home in the Sabi sand. Very nice. The youngsters, as Jandre pans off to the left and then zooms in, there they are. Much like the waterbuck we get at home, look like little donkeys. And this is the same species, it's a different subspecies. Isn't that a gorgeous scene? I know it's a bit rainy, but it is still very pretty indeed. I might have to take a picture with this enormous cannon I have here. Cannon, I mean, as in weapon. Now, I took two, you will have heard. As you come back towards this swampy area, there's a very large goose. Can you see the goose, Jandre? That's him. That is a spur-wing goose, everybody, and as far as I'm aware, Africa's largest goose. He probably stands, a view to stretch him out. If he was to stretch his neck forward, I reckon he's almost 4 feet long. Then, also in this area, as Jandre zooms out a little and then pans to the left, we have a sacred ibis, which is normally a sort of aquatic animal eater. There it's eating, probably looking for frogs and things. And yesterday, however, the sacred ibis that we found was stealing bits of wildebeest from a crocodile. It was a very brave sacred ibis, of course. I think they're magnificent birds. I'm sad we don't see more of them at home. Then, Gendre, if you didn't mind coming back to the right-hand side, you can see some jacanas. Just keep going right past the goose and zooming in over round about there. You should see a jacana or two there, middle of the screen. You've got a jacana. That's the same version that you see knocking about on Arethusa Dam when there's water in it. A lily trotter with its very long toes. You can see how long the toes are there, actually. And then there's also a pied kingfisher hovering. Look at that. With the most perfect scenery behind. Stay there, bird. I'm going to take a picture of you. Oh, I got it, everyone. Should be quite fun. How cool is that? Gendre, that's beautifully done. Well done. That is very cool indeed. And there he sits on the edge of a little branch. Then I did see what I thought was a pygmy kingfisher, but it may have been a malachite, but I think it was pygmy. The only reason I'm a bit confused, there it is. It is a malachite, actually. Is it? I've lost my mind. Let me get my bird app out. Gendre, you stay there on that one. We know that's pied. Can't mistake that. It's black and white. It's malachite. I'm getting confirmation from the ornithologist / general manager of Angama that it is a malachite kingfisher. Now, Gendre, where it is basically if you pull out from the pied and go into the middle of the swamp, there is a small group of sort of reedy-like sticks sticking out to the left. Zoom in to the right of the goose. There. Zoom in slowly there and I'll direct you. I think those might be the very sticks. Yep, just keep going in there. No, they're not the right sticks. Go right a bit at that level. Keep going. Keep going. Keep going. No, I think you've gone too far. Sorry, everybody, this is quite difficult to try and find because I'm sat in the car. Okay, you see the jacana, Gendre? Yeah. Just to the right of the jacana, there, and further to the back of the swamp, there's a little thing of sticks. Okay, to the left. We've got him now. Keep going to the left. Tyler spotted him. There he is. You got him. Beastly bird. Right, malachite kingfisher, that's very nice. And a rather splendid scene. And I'll just let's zoom all the way out, if you don't mind, and we'll give you an idea of exactly where we are. There's the Olulolo escarpment that I have to sort of pause before saying every time. Absolutely astounding picture we have here. Isn't that gorgeous? And there the rain falling in the south and the east. Kathy, you want to know what an escarpment is? I've always just known it as a sort of mountain range or rising that goes up to a plateau. So this goes onto a plateau that slopes gently down towards Lake Victoria, as far as I'm aware. But we'd call the Drakensberg that you can see from the Sabi Sand an escarpment. And basically it's the rising of land once you move away from the coastal plain up onto a plateau. That's, as far as I can understand it, what an escarpment is. Thank you for that question, Kathy. Mostly, of course, because I haven't thought about how to define it for so very long. What an astoundingly gorgeous scene, yet another one. It's very difficult to find anything in this place that you want to look at that you don't think, I don't think that's very nice. Except, of course, in the case of Mr. Wallington when he sees a topi. Gorgeous stuff. Righty, well, I think we'll press on from here. We're going to head towards those lions, the earlier lions that we saw, everyone. Apparently, may or may not, it's very difficult to tell, may or may not have killed a zebra. We're hoping that the zebra was not killed by them and that they're not going to eat it and that they're going to kill another one. Not because we don't like zebras, but because we'd quite like to catch them killing live, because that is, after all, one of the major reasons that we came to this area. That is the sacred ibis. Hello, cat in Tampa. You say that the sacred ibis makes 100 birds for you, and you want to know if you're allowed to combine your Sabi sand and Mara birdless together. Cat, you can absolutely. I give you full permission to do that. Well, it's all on the African continent, and if you were a worldwide birder, then you'd have a life list that consisted of all the birds you'd ever seen. So you can have a safari live bird list, and when we're eventually watching hyacinth macaws streaming overhead around the jungles and clearings of South America, well, then you can include those too. Of course, that's if we can get Mr. Wallington to stop at the hyacinth macaw and not move on towards the jaguars. The smell of rain is in the air, everybody, and I don't know if you've ever been around, I'm sure most of you have been around a swampy area like this. I think that they just smell lovely. They smell very fertile. A slight, I suppose, fishy whiff in the air, but that's quite pleasant out here. As the soft pitter-patter of rain slowly drenches Jean-André, who he has put on his raincoat. That's very unusual. That's very good. Now, James Richard, you're wondering if those Defasa waterbuck smell the same as the ones we get back home. I've driven past quite a few of them, I've got to tell you, and I don't remember smelling that very nice sort of peaty, musty smell. So I don't know. I wonder. Alrighty, Jean-André, let us press on from here. I have got the roof back on, everyone. It is raining, so you will be unable to see me. There you are. I'm just under that. I'll knock on it for you. There you are. That's me greeting you. Hello, Raccoon. You want to know if Graham is holding the umbrella again? Graham is holding the umbrella. This is the, it's the quintessential sort of definition, if you like, there he is, of the servant leader. Graham has spotted a heron. The fact that he has decided to stop for it means that he's probably very sick. Is it a Goliath? It's a Goliath heron, everyone. Say when, Jean-André. Okay. Gosh, that is magnificent. That is the Goliath heron, everyone. The largest, unsurprisingly, with a name like that, of the heron species. Certainly the ones we get here. I don't know if there are any bigger ones in North America, are there?
Not this big.
This is the biggest. And he's very patiently, shaking water off his feathers. Look how he's able to close them back onto his body. Isn't that amazing? And very patiently trawling for fish. I'm sure he'd take frogs very happily as well. Now, when I say he's big, obviously it's very difficult for you to tell from where you're looking now. I think he's probably from the tip of his toes, if you were to stretch his neck and his beak out, not far shy of 5.5 feet tall. He might even be slightly taller than that. No, let's call him 5.5 if you stretched him out. Good. That is a very nice spot. I'm just having another quick look through the window here. There, you can see Jean-André's technical efforts at attaching the infrared lights. Well done, Jean-André. Beautiful work there. You can see Jean-André, very neat. I hope that VM Doornbruck doesn't see that. Let's head across to Jamie Patterson. She is still sitting with the Nkahuma pride in their little cubbies. Please give them my very best regards.
Little Nkahuma cubbies. James sends his best regards to all of you. What do you say to that? Little things? I don't think they're terribly bothered. Cute. Look at them, all settled down and thoroughly peaceful. If you missed our extended sunset safari a couple of days ago, we had the most incredible experience with them, and I'll explain a little bit. Halo, before we chat about that incredible experience, I mentioned that perhaps there's a possibility that the males are off making new little littermates for these little ones, and you want to know what will happen with those cubs. Will they stay with their pride, or will they join their fathers? And the answer to that is that they will stay with their pride. So what happens with a female is when she's pregnant, she'll give birth somewhere nice and secret, and she'll keep the cubs hidden from everybody, including her own sisters, her mother, the rest of the pride. And only when they're about 6 weeks old will she take them out to introduce them. And we've been fortunate enough actually to even witness when the youngest set of Nkuhumas were introduced to the rest of the pride. And the reason that she does that is because they're so small and fragile that the older boisterous cubs could actually do them damage, not intentionally, but just by playing with them. And then they will stay with the rest of the pride, if they're females, for the rest of their life, most likely. So the females will stay together unless the pride does get too large or something happens. But the general situation is that the females stay with the rest of the pride. If they are males, they will be kicked out at around 2.5-3 years old when they reach sexual maturity. It just depends on the circumstances, what age they're kicked out. And generally, they will form their own coalition and they will not join with their fathers. And the reason behind that is similar to what we were discussing with Michael's question, in that we don't, or they don't want, the lions have sort of evolved the system so that they don't breed with their... Lions are not big on personal space. So it's that they don't breed with their mothers. So they won't join their fathers because their fathers are in control of lionesses that are related to them. And instinct drives them to disperse away from that area. So they move off and they find their own territory. And it'll take them many years. For a good few years, they'll be pretty much nomadic, kind of like Junior, depending on how many males are with them. They'll be exploring, looking for perhaps a vacuum where there are no male lions, or perhaps where there's a weakness, old male lions where they can move in and take over. This little one is too cute. Oh, thoroughly cleaning its paws. Back to the milk bar. Madeline, speaking of lion prides, and I said that sometimes they do get very, very big, you wanted to know if they ever split as a result of being too big into smaller prides, or if so, how does that happen? The answer is yes, they can. So one of the largest prides of this area is off towards the Limbombo Mountains, to the east of Kruger. Little one, you want some milk too? Poor mom. So what will happen then, because you've got so many mouths to feed, and I mean that is one point numbered 40 lions, that particular pride, is they'll split off generally into smaller groups. So the females with their daughters will often stay together, and sisters. So it depends on the tightest bonds within the pride itself. Shame, little one, did you get pushed away? Much as they fight over carcasses, they also occasionally have little squabbles over who gets to drink from the milk bar first. Madeline, the other situation where a pride might split is in the case of a male coalition takeover. So what happens there is males come in, and as you know, males, when they come into an area, will kill all cubs that are not theirs. But the females are obviously invested in trying to prevent that from happening. So often what will happen is females with young cubs will run, leaving the females from their pride that don't have cubs to sort of intervene and start mating with the males and hopefully distract them enough that their own cubs don't get killed. That almost invariably doesn't work, but it does occasionally, which is how the Salalah Breakaway Pride came to be, unless I'm very much mistaken. A female left with her young cubs and managed to keep them alive, and hence it was a new pride. So since we do have such a wonderful, peaceful scene, our lions are not going anywhere, let's head across all the way to Cheetah Plains and see what Brent has in store for you.
Smell us a cheetah, please.
No, I think he's tracking a herd. And when you see an elephant smelling the ground like that, it's probably smelling another elephant. Just move a little bit further forward.
Now, welcome to Cheetah Plains Private Game Reserve. We are live in the middle of the African bush. And we are with this glorious big elephant bull. And I'm hoping he's going to march right up to us. But it looks like he smelt something that's changed his mind. Look at that. Oh, has he found something good to eat? What are you smelling there, but? So he could be just kicking. No, he's found something under the ground there. He's sniffed up a treat. What have you found? Well, there could just be some minerals in the soil he's after. And we don't see the elephants on these big open plains too often at the moment with the grass being so scarce. Hi, Shane. Now, Shane's wondering, will elephants eat the earth for salt? They do, Shane, but not only for salt, for other minerals as well. And I'm not sure what he's sniffed out there. It could be some salt or some minerals in the soil. And he's still digging. It could be a tuber or a bulb of a plant under the ground as well. Look at that. Oh, whatever it was quite small. Or maybe he didn't get it all out. Lovely young bull. Well, he is the only living creature out in the, well, only living mammal, should I say, out in the open plains at the moment. I thought he was going to march straight towards us, but he's just picked up a scent of something under the ground there, and he's really keen on getting out. It's amazing how they use their feet in collaboration with their trunks to perform some incredible excavations and movements. Now, I've even seen elephant bulls of this size go down onto their knees to use their tusks to dig. But that ground looks quite soft, so it probably doesn't need his tusks. It's almost like whatever the little thing on the ground is frustrating him. Shake your head at it.
Now, earlier in the drive, I did pop a flower on the dash, and no one's got it right yet. And the next one in was the knobthorn, which is also incorrect. Now, remember, I showed you the seed. I'll see if I can find another one. They're not too common down here on Cheetah Plains. Oh, did you get it, Dex? What are you digging up? It must be a bulb or a tuber. Oh, there we go. Oh, look at that. Imagine that. Now, he smelt that through the ground. A tasty treat. Now, you probably find this ground was too hard before the rain for him to smell it. I wonder what it was. Oh, down the hatch. And he's continuing his march towards us. I wonder if he finds another one. You can see how his trunk's so close to the ground. And normally when you see them doing that, so they're following a herd. But in this case, I actually think he's sniffing for those bulbs under the ground. Could be a tall white squirrel. This is the plant he's munching on. They have a nice tuber of about that size. And you can see he's had a drink. You can see that bottom half of his trunk is slightly darker. Oh, it looks like he wants to shake his head at us.
No, don't be naughty. We haven't done anything. You just stay calm. There we go. Good boy.
Now, he's just trying to show us he was boss there. Bit of a cheeky streak in this chap, so immediately I like him. So, in a lot of cases, this is where people get into trouble with elephants in a situation like that. They drive away fast. And all that does is teach elephants how to chase the cars, and they think it's a great game. And so he was probably expecting me to rush off. And so I just started the vehicle, just that noise, and I tapped the side of the car. And I spoke a little bit louder, and you can see he's not running away from us. He's not particularly scared, or he's not scared at all. Oh, look at that. Amazing. Incredibly strong animals. So you can see his body language now. Oh, what's he digging again? Is he after the roots of that small acacia? Or is there something else there? You can actually hear him breathe, blow out there. Saw the dust come. You can see his body language now. He's completely relaxed again. And you see, very important with elephants, their tails. As soon as that tail's a bit stiff, and can be that they're a bit upset, but you can see his tail's hanging limp, and he showed us who's boss, and we came to a stalemate. Now, he purposely sought us out to come have a closer inspection. So when he saw our vehicle, he actually changed his direction towards us. Now, Lisa was wondering how old this beautiful boy is. I'd say he's about 30, Lisa. Maybe a few years either way. And he is coming into his prime. Probably weighs about 12,000 pounds. Hi, Raj. Raj is wondering what exactly is he searching for. Well, Raj, anything to eat at the moment. So he's found what I think is a tall white squilled tuber that he was digging. And now he's gone onto a knobthorn tree. We can hear a constant in the background. It's that long-tailed shrike or magpie shrike calling. Now, to give you an idea about how tough an elephant's skin there, if you or I had to grab that branch, our fingers, our hands and skin would be completely ripped apart. Now, Nicole's wondering, do you, animals like these elephants have a preference with which foot they use? I've never actually noticed a preference in feet, but with tusks, definitely. You normally have right or left tusked elephants. So the one tusk will be slightly more worn as they use it more for feeding or digging. Fighting, they use both. But we're going to leave this boy now. He's going to keep moving. I think he's going to head east towards the Kruger. And we're gonna, I've heard a report that there's some vultures near our boundary to the north of us. So there's someone from the north checking, but there could be a kill this side. Fingers crossed it's a leopard. Now, if you are new and you've just happened upon us live in the African bush, yes, we are live. And if you don't believe me, send a question. You can do that by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or pop an email to questions@wildearth.tv. Isn't it very exciting? You saw that elephant at the exact same time I did, and we are incredibly lucky to be able to share the wonders of bush with you wherever you might be in the world. Now, I was expecting vast herds of zebra and wildebeest, something like what James has been saying, but it doesn't look like the zebra or wildebeest are on the open plains today. No sign of the cheetah either, but I'm going to have a quick look in this far eastern corner for my favourite leopard. The last time I saw her was right here. Now, speaking of massive herds of wildebeest and zebra and such, the best place to see that is, of course, in the Mara Triangle with James.
Now, what we have here, everybody, is a rather interesting situation. We started off this afternoon, not with you, but we came past this area and found these two lions over here. And the two lions were sort of in the right place wind-wise for a herd of zebra, and we thought they might kill, we thought they might not, we heard of other lions, so we left them. And in the interim, what they did was kill that young zebra, disembowel it seemingly, and then they came and lay here, which is somewhat worse, about 100 meters or 330 feet from where they killed it. And it's very strange indeed. We're not really sure why. They don't look very full to me. If we look at the, if we can go back to the lions there, gendry. That lioness does not look well satiated to me. So, fascinating. I just think that they are all perhaps not very, you know, that none of them are particularly hungry. And so maybe they'll go back to it and feed later. Maybe they'll kill one of the wildebeest in the background there a bit later. That's possible. But what's also interesting, of course, is that the cousins and brothers and perhaps even parents of that zebra are still grazing behind it. So it's all rather odd. We're learning every single day that we're here, the strange things that go on in the Mara Triangle, how they differ from the things that happen on Cheetah Plains, for example. And thankfully the rain has stayed away from us so far. But I'm not sure how long that situation is going to persist. Now, we're looking at one or two dead zebras here. And James Richard, you're wondering about the mass of these zebras. You say you have read that they are smaller than the virtual zebra that we get at home. This is the Grant's zebra, everybody. It's the same species. It's a different subspecies from the virtuals that we get in the Saabye Sand. I would say it is noticeable that they're smaller. I'm not sure exactly what the mass difference is. I would say probably about 5 to 10% if I was to guess, but I will check it up for you if you like. probably about 10%. They're slightly smaller. The most noticeable thing for me about them is A, that they don't have any shadow stripes, so those are the stripes between the black and white, which of course the virtuals down in South Africa do. They've got a sort of grey-brown stripe between the black and white bits, and also they've got a very distinctively rounded nose. Now, I used to ride horses, and, well, I still do sometimes, but we used to describe a horse like that as having a Roman nose, a kind of bulge just at the bottom, and that's what these chaps look like. They look like they've got a kind of Roman nose, as opposed to the much straighter skull and straighter forehead of the virtual zebra. If I was to choose one from the other, I would say that I thought the virtual zebra from home was maybe a slightly more handsome animal than this Grant's zebra. But they are both very splendid, and they are, like I say, part of the same species. Just look at that. I mean, where on earth can you see a view like that other than here in the Mara Triangle? Obviously a little bit macabre with the recently deceased zebra in the bottom left-hand corner. Especially as it seems to be slightly wasted. But something will come and eat that, everybody, be it vultures or hyenas, those scavenging male lions from around this area. I'm not surprised they look full the whole time. These females kill. It's almost like they've kind of left supper on the table for the males and then gone off. Gone off on a girl's night out, made supper for their husbands. They're not very empowered. Jen B, you say, is it possibly too hot for them to eat right now? No, Jen B, it's not hot at all. It's probably about 20 degrees Celsius, which is, give me a 1 second, I'll work it out for you, around about 70 degrees Fahrenheit. You can see blood on her muzzle there. You know, normally if a lion has had to expend an enormous amount of effort killing something, and they're too tired or too hot to eat, they'll lie next to the kill. They won't leave it and come down here. I'll tell you what I think may have happened here. There was a herd of buffalo around here, and I don't think there are any of them around here now. And I think possibly the buffalo got wind. Yeah, the buffalo in the background, they're way in the background. I wonder if those buffalo didn't see the dastardly lions take down the zebra and then chase them off. That could well have happened. So we might see a kill later on if the buffalo decide that these lions shouldn't eat that zebra. Then it's possible. Maybe one of those wildebeest will wander too close. But certainly these lions, like the lions all over Africa, are absolute opportunists. So whatever comes too close to them, they will kill, regardless of whether they're hungry or not. But I think these guys are not unhungry. I think they are... Is unhungry a word, Jean-André? No, it's not, is it? I think they are hungry and certainly could eat. And maybe they'll go back to the zebra, maybe they'll kill something else a little bit later. Sorry, the splendor of this place is boiling my brain. Well, that's an interesting one, Tracy. Let me retrieve my binoculars. Oh. You say, you say that dead zebra looks quite fat. Could it be pregnant? I must confess to you, I think that's a rather good theory. Yeah, I think it is quite fat. We can drive around there and have a look. In fact, why don't we do that? Jean-André, would you like to do that? Jean-André went, I don't know what that means. So I thought, just think we'll go anyway. I must confess, everyone, I had a very shocking experience just before we came live. Jean-André has taken his boots off and his foot was sitting on the back of my chair and I touched it. And that was, you know, it took a lot of courage for me to even be able to come live at all. How is this ditch?
It's a nice ditch.
Well, you may well ask, Rebecca, you say, why are his shoes off? Good question. No one really knows. And Jean-André has become mute, so it's not possible to ask him. Oh, I see. He says now that his mother taught him to not to stand on the furniture with his shoes on. My mother taught me not to stand on the furniture at all. Let's have a quick look at her. You can see she's very distressed by the sight of Jean-André. She looks deeply stressed out, doesn't she? She goes back to sleep. The lions of the Mara Triangle do enjoy a good sleep, much like lions everywhere, I suppose. Ah, look how spotty she is on her belly. Now, I'm beginning to wonder, and on her feet. She's maintained a lot more spotting, and I don't think she's that young. She's maintained a lot. Look at her nose there. I'd say she was about 3 years old with a nose like that, so she's quite young. We know that from the blackening. By the time they're six, especially apparently in East Africa, the lions have got completely black noses. That one's got quite a lot of pink on it. I'd put it about three, but that's the most spotting I've ever seen on an adult lioness. And I'm just beginning to wonder, Mr. Wallington, if this isn't the lioness that we saw the first night with those males. She was very heavily spotted.
But then who would be the other lioness?
Yes, Mr. Wallington, that is a very salient query at this stage of the game, to which I do not have an answer, I'm afraid. Okay, let's go and have a look at that zebra, the deceased one. Now, although this does look like a very easy place to drive through, there is the odd ditch, so we'll just drive very slowly and easily through here. But we've very kindly been allowed to use this particular area. It's just below Angama Mara where we're staying, and we've been kindly allowed to use it, and thankfully that is the case, because further south where we were originally going to use, there are more rocks than you can shake a stick at. If you wanted to shake some sticks at rocks. And I'm sorry about the bumping around. If you're starting to feel nauseous, just shut your eyes and I shall tell you what's happening. Jean-André, are you feeling nauseous yet? Jean-André did have some nausea the other day after our lion hunt, but he survived, everyone. He has some very heavy anti-motion sickness tablets that he takes. Strong enough, apparently, to knock out a small horse. Right, we're approaching the site of the crime. I'm just going to warn you, everybody, I don't know what we're going to see around here. It could be fairly It could be fairly distressing, so I'm going to warn you that if you don't wish to see the gore... Hang on, John, just wait a second. Then you need to shut your eyes now. Because I think that the theory that Tracy had might not be incorrect. No, that just looks like a very large piece of cecum that's come out there. No, it's all right, everybody. I don't think there's a baby zebra. Well, there might be inside, but it's not out now. Jan, you want to know, as we look at this rather horrendous sight, why are there no vultures around here or hyenas? There is one vulture, and Jandri will show it to you just now. It's in the only tree, well, it's in the closest tree to us. Oh dear. We've lost battery.
Whoopsie daisy, I think we lost James there in the Mara. Not lost him forever, just temporarily misplaced him. But your timing could not be more impeccable because we have just stumbled upon this massive male giraffe. Okay, so it's not a Messiah giraffe, but I happen to think ours are just as lovely. Our Southern African giraffe, of course, the world of conservation abuzz with the news that we have now divided giraffe into four different species, thus ending the debate, the mass debate, about subspecies and species and the Rothschilds and all of that. There was much debate about with the ecologists as to whether or not they were classified as subspecies or actual distinct species. And genetic testing has now shown that they have not interbred for many, many, many years, so completely distinct genetic lines and therefore separate species. And he's playing hide-and-go-seek with us. I think he thinks we think he's a tree. I have to tell you, Mr. Giraffe, I'm not fooled. I can see you. Probably this big male giraffe weighs over a ton. Isn't he absolutely beautiful, though? A giraffe bull in his prime. The dark colour, immediately suggesting to us that it's a male. You've got to be careful, though, because just like human beings and hair colours, giraffe have different skin tones. But in this case, he is very clearly a male, because we can see by the size and then those thick ossicones on the top of his head. Rubbed bald by fighting with other male giraffe. Now, I've definitely recognized this individual. It's the funny thing about doing these live safaris is you start to look through the eyes of the camera, and as a result you start to identify individuals. Which way are you going, mister? Must you be hidden behind the one tree? Yes. I would like to chat a little bit more about him. Let me see if I can reposition. Maybe we'll get a better view from Buffles of Cutline. Let's give it a go. Completely relaxed. He knows that there's not much out here that's a threat to him, except for maybe a large pride of lions. Now, the Nkuhumas have been seen hunting giraffe before. I've never seen them take one down. Nor have I ever encountered them on a giraffe kill, although I'm sure it has happened in the past. Ah, this is slightly better. Ooh. There we go, Rusty coming to a subtle halt. Sorry everybody, squeaky brakes. And an awkward angle, but we've finally got a clear view of this magnificent bull. Oh goodness. I've got my handbrake right up and Rusty's still attempting to take us down the hill. Sorry, Rusty. Look at him surveying the world from his 6 meter high perch, sort of. I suppose you can't really call it a perch. And he's not even ruminating at the moment, which I thought he might be. Generally, when you encounter giraffe and they're standing still like this, they're either feeding or ruminating. And he seems to be doing neither. Just quite peacefully standing and giving us an amazing view. And the longer you look at giraffe, the weirder they look, in my opinion. Those bizarre elongated faces. And then look at the hooked lip that he has there. Incredibly nimble. Oh, he's giving us a perfect... there we go. Now he's ruminating. Very nimble top lip that works in conjunction with the tongue to help grasp the various leaves and avoid the thorns. And if you look, you can see he doesn't have any oxpeckers on him, but he does have a collection of exoparasites in the form of ticks. Lots of ticks sitting around his ears and his ossicones. Oh, that must be so itchy. Speaking from experience, I find tick bites unbearably itchy, far worse than mosquito bites. Yet our animals don't seem to be terribly bothered, but perhaps he ought to go and find some oxpeckers to help remove those particular ticks. Oh, there they are, all clustered behind his ear. How very uncomfortable. You almost want to go and pick them off for him. Look closely. This is actually an awesome view. Have a look behind his ossicones at the two bumps on the top of his head, or sort of where his neck meets the top of his head. Now that is one of the big indicators that this is a male giraffe. You can see them in the females, but they're far more prominent in the males, and essentially are like little sub-ossicones. You can even see he's rubbed a bald patch on the top of one. So that combined with the ossicones themselves and then the bulge on the top of his forehead, the solid bone, provide a really intimidating battering ram. So when male giraffe fight, they do what's known as necking, swinging their heads around and bashing their opponent on the side or the legs or wherever they happen to reach. And hello to Rennie. While we sit with our big, what's known as a stink bull, he wanted to know whether or not, and I'll explain the reference in a moment, Rennie wanted to know, do a giraffe ever get aggressive with humans? Yes, occasionally they do, particularly stink bulls that are in the prime of their life. They're called stink bulls because they start to secrete a pheromone that absolutely stinks. It smells like human feces. It's revolting. And occasionally they do get aggressive, particularly if they've become very, very comfortable around humans. And I think it must be, I've never experienced it before in any major way, but I think it must be utterly terrifying to be charged by a giraffe. They're massive. They're incredibly tall. They can kick with those powerful legs or knock with their heads. And there's a fascinating video, Rennie, if you're interested, of a guide racing away from a giraffe. And you can hear the tone of confusion in his voice. You should be able to find it somewhere on YouTube. You can hear the confusion in his voice while he sort of races away from this giraffe. And he's calling the sighting in on the Game Drive channel going, "I'm being attacked by a giraffe." I do have friends that were, their vehicle was very badly kicked in by a giraffe, an angry male that reached around and walloped the vehicle and broke the window and bent the windscreen. The giraffe was fine, the car was not. And I also know I've experienced once a habituated giraffe calf that had been hand-raised, and let me tell you, that thing was terrifying. At 4 months old, they might be tiny by giraffe standards, but they're definitely not tiny by human standards. And it was incredibly scary. This thing used to just come bolting at you. It was an angry little thing. Truly terrifying experience. So yes, a giraffe do occasionally, but for the most part, they are innocuous, gentle creatures. It's very, very rare that something like that occurs, as it is for most of the different animals out here. Nothing is really out to get us. Occasionally an elephant might give us a little bit of nonsense, like that bull with Brent, who I'm pretty sure is our friend from yesterday, because he's done that to me a few times as well. Lovely. Right, I need to get off the main road because there is somebody very patiently waiting for me to move, not the giraffe, a truck. So while we do that, let's head back over to the Mara and see what James is up to now that the battery's all sorted out.
About that, everybody. Gendre has been thoroughly chastised. We've beaten him, stolen his hat, thrown it into the wilderness, and he'll never let the battery discharge again. He's in tears. Now, that was very evil of me. We're going to go back to the zebra. I'm just going to warn you. Look, it's not distressing, but it is disgusting. So if you are perhaps feeling a little peaky, or you've just had your supper, you might want to not look. Now, what we're looking at there, everyone, is the zebra's cecum. Now, for those of you who are interested in biology, I think that's quite an interesting piece of organ. Many of you will think that's absolute nonsense, but it is interesting because you actually have a cecum, but it's in the form of something called your appendix. And in a zebra, which is a hindgut fermenter, and this is not something we're often able to talk about because zebras don't generally wander around with their cecums hanging out of their bodies. You can see there it's enormous, and that is the fermentation vat in a hindgut fermenter. So if you're a hindgut fermenter and you need to digest grass and vegetation, that's where it happens, as opposed to a ruminant, for example, which has the fermentation taking place in the foregut or the front stomach, the four-chambered stomach of the rumen, at least of the ruminant. The rumen is just one of those chambers. So I think that's quite interesting. And we, of course, have a vestigial cecum, and that is the appendix, which we know, of course, we can take out should it become inflamed and explode, which apparently is very painful indeed. Jean-Ré, do you still have your cecum? Jean-Ré still has his cecum, everyone. What a relief. Do you have your cecum, Graham?
That's when I last checked. Yes.
When he last checked, Graham had his cecum, which is excellent news. Now, let's pan around, because there's not really much else to say about that hapless zebra, which hasn't been eaten. But we can see there the wildebeest and the zebra in the foreground. And then I think, if I'm not mistaken, Jandri, those are buffalo in the background, aren't they? Yes, they are. And so that is my theory. My theory is that the buffalo chased off the lions before they could eat here, and that's why they haven't eaten. Now, what they'll probably do is come back at some stage and start eating this thing, unless the wildebeest and zebras start to lurk even closer to them. And, sorry, I'm just being distracted by a bird flying across the clearing onto the top of that tree there. There we go, where there is one single vulture sitting. And I'm just going to get my binoculars and see what that is. Tyler, any ideas?
Brown snake eagle.
Tyler says brown snake eagle. I concur. And then there's a vulture next to that. Looks like a white-backed, I think. And in the background, the African thunder rolls. Mercifully, we have had no rain. Well, we've had a little bit of rain on us, sufficient to wet Jandré, but the rest of us have remained dry, which is excellent. Now, Jandré, I don't mean to cause you trouble. Well, you know that's not true, but I have to say it anyway. The lion's just sat up behind us. This is a horrible angle. Are you right? Can you do it? Or shall I move the car? He's quite an agile fellow, Jandré, for a man of car with calves his size. There we are. Beautiful. Stunning. And in the background, what we'd call a ring-necked dove. I'm pretty sure it's called a ring-necked dove here as well. You can hear it going broop, 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 in the same way that they do in South Africa. I've always found doves to have the most comforting calls. I don't know why, but perhaps that's why they're the birds of peace. And if you want peace in your life, everyone, as I've often said to you while fossicking about in Juma, an African landscape like this, where there is no sound other than the sounds of nature, well, I've got to tell you, it'll fill you with a sense of peace the likes of which you've never had. Here come the lions. I think it's well worth waiting here. We did facetiously suggest driving over the top of the zebra so that the lions were forced to kill again, but then we decided that would probably be a little bit unkind, so we're not going to do that. We weren't, just in case you think I'm being serious, we weren't actually thinking about doing that.
Well, Jandré, no, we weren't actually thinking about doing that.
Graham says, no, we weren't genuinely actually thinking about doing that. Hello, Michael. You say, oh, how wonderful. You say this is your first Mara drive since we got here because you've been at school. Well, I'm sorry about that, Michael, but you're obviously very keen on this area because you say, is this the marsh pride or are they on the other side of the river? You've got it exactly. This is not the marsh pride. They are on the other side of the river. This pride, we think, is a pride known as the Out of Africa pride and seems to consist of two or three females, and there may even be some cubs. Two cubs is what we've heard, but because I'll just give you a bit of an idea. Because around here, the woodlands often don't have any grass, at least any roads going into them. It's very difficult to sort of get off, and nobody goes off on foot to check. It's difficult to know exactly what the case is. But this is the Out of Africa Pride. We've been following the Kichwa Tembo Pride, who has strong connections to the Marsh Pride. Indeed, many of the females from there apparently are a breakaway of the Marsh Prides, Michael. So that's quite interesting. We'll probably go and see them a little bit later, especially if we think they might hunt. Isn't she beautiful? That's me taking a couple of pictures. Sorry about the sound. One day they'll make a silent shutter and I'll be able to fire off like a machine gun without you knowing about it. So, Michael, and then also related to the Marsh Pride, of course, Scarface the male lion. We saw him 2 days ago. What a magnificent beast he is. I think the biggest and most impressive male lion I've ever seen. And it was just fantastic to spend a bit of time with him. And you would have known him from, of course, the Big Cat Diaries. And we've met his brother, Morani. And we've met the two usurpers who apparently tossed him out of here. The blondies, we'll call them for now. The other four males of the four musketeers, which were... Oh, look at her. Which were Scarface, Morani, Sekio and Hunter. There we go, I can't believe I remembered that. We haven't met Sekio and Hunter. We don't know where they are at this stage, but most probably back across the river with the Marsh Pride. There she goes. And you might just in the background be able to hear the zebra going, which is them alarm calling. I'm just going to watch out for the other lioness who's not coming this way, which is quite interesting. She is watching us. So, chaps, very small movements if you're going to move at all. I don't mean everyone at home. She's not that good. She can't quite see you through the lens. Isn't this amazing? It truly is an astounding landscape. Everywhere you look, there is something amazing to see. Lioness feeding here. Just away to the right-hand side of your screen, you've got a huge herd of wildebeest, which are now, they've seen this lioness coming up here. Zebra, buffalo, the Ololo escarpment stretching up into the sky. Huge grey clouds surrounding us, dumping rain on this fertile ecosystem. Thankfully not dumping it on us just yet. Hello, Snoop. She's chasing some flies now. Snoop, you say how large of an... You say, how large of an area are we able to traverse here in the Mara compared to that of Juma? Snoop, a huge area. We're able to traverse an area the entire size, well, about 9,000 hectares smaller than the Sabi Sands. So we can move through an area of 51,000 hectares in acres. That is roughly 130,000 acres or so, which is quite impressive, and we can go anywhere there that we like, and that's the great joy of it, of course. Now, these zebra are starting to come closer. I'm just going to... John is going to stay on this lioness who's being slightly ridiculous. She's re-killing her zebra. And I must just reiterate, for those of you who are sensitive, I'm sorry about this, but this is, of course, typical cat behavior. And you can see there, Jean, on the bottom of the neck there, if you zoom in, you can see where she took hold of it, where she grabbed the throat of the zebra earlier on and killed it. The other lioness still not coming, not interested, and the zebra and the wildebeest all moving slowly closer to make sure or to find out what's going on here. Michael in New York, a very nice question from you, and I haven't seen it, but it certainly does happen. You say, have I ever seen a lioness injured badly by a zebra? Because, of course, they can kick extremely hard, And it does happen that they get injured. I've never seen it. And I think in this ecosystem, it probably happens more often than it does in other ecosystems. And that's because, of course, they eat, I think, more zebra. There are more zebra for them to eat. Now everyone's alarm calling. I'm just going to be quiet for a while. You can feel the wind blowing, I'm sure. I've got to tell you, the smell of this place is just, it's clean, it's raw. I can't smell the zebra cecum, thankfully. And it is Africa. Now, she's not full. She can definitely eat, and that's great. Means that she has not killed for no reason. Slowly now, the herds are moving closer. I think let's have a quick look at them, Gendre, if you don't... maybe not. I don't know what she thinks she's doing, why she's trying to drag it somewhere. There's no thicket behind which she can put it. There is a termite mound just behind us that I suppose she might try and drag it behind. And she's just watching the zebra now, and the wildebeest. She's not huge, you know, so I mean, maybe she's not quite 3 years old yet. Maybe she's got a little bit of growing to do still. Now, I can tell you this is not the same lioness we saw on the first day, and I'll tell you how I know that. The other one's coming up now. I know that because it's not because of her spotting. It's because she does not have swollen teats like that other lioness did. And apparently the lioness with those two blondies on the first night that we were here, apparently she had just lost her cubs to those blonde males. Look at that, it's bizarre. Absolutely bizarre. She's not making any effort to open it up and eat it. It might be the fact that the wildebeest and zebra are moving closer. It's unlikely, I think, that they would try and chase her off here. She's not making an enormous effort to try and get in there, and that just indicates to me she's not particularly hungry. She knows she'll eat. If she loses this one, she'll have something else to kill fairly soon. Okay, Jean, let's just quickly, if you don't mind, have a look at the herd and how they've come back up towards her. I probably haven't parked in the easiest place for old Gendry here. He likes a challenge, though. There they are. You can see them all looking up now as the lioness got up and came to this area. And they're all going... That's alarm calling. And you can't hear it because the ambient microphone is covered by the rain cover, which is, of course, extremely important because it would break were the rain to fall upon it. Might even electrocute Gendre, and then his hair would be even more unwieldy than it is now. Do you want me to move slightly? Or are you happy here? He says, which I think means no, we're okay over here. All right, let's watch the other lioness. Here she comes now. Gosh, this is marvellous, isn't it? Watching the lioness, but look at the view behind her. There, I caught a whiff, I'm afraid, of the zebra's cecum. It wasn't particularly pleasant. What you can see, however, I'll just tell you about it. While this lioness comes over here, there is absolutely no reaction from the buffalo to the lions as they've come here now. One or two have looked up, but the rest of the herd is gathering. I think they're gathering and snoozing because it's getting a little bit cold. I'm just taking some pictures. Hopefully we'll be able to recognize these lions the next time we come. And I'd love for you to try and pick up some distinguishing features. Take some screenshots. Let's get some distinguishing features. Obviously, those spots might fade a little bit, but these two lionesses are easy to distinguish from each other. One of them seems to be lactating, although she's got swollen teats, but she doesn't seem to have very clear suckle marks. You've all been watching, of course, the... This is bizarre. You've been watching the Nkuhuma pride, and you know, of course, that they've got very, very obvious suckle marks. The area around the teats become really quite worn. Beautiful. I'm just going to do a quick comms check with the final control. Rebecca, have we still got you there? Okay, good. There we go. Just making sure. Now, they're trying to get into the bottom, and that is the softest place for lions to get. So that's probably where they'll begin, especially as the kind of first hole that they've made has been... Well, it's kind of been, you know, hang on a second. The first hole that they've made has been blocked, obviously, by the guts that have come out. You know what? I don't think these lions killed the zebra. I'll tell you why. I got a story from one of the guides earlier today that said he had seen a zebra in this area that had died around here. It tried to do a crossing the other day, was grabbed by a crocodile, came into this area, and its guts had started to come out. I think this is that zebra. I don't think they killed this thing. They definitely had a go at it. But I think the swelling there that you're seeing, and the fact that it already doesn't have quite have rigor mortis, perhaps. I think they're scavenging here. That's quite interesting. Hello, Ravi. You say, it seems as if there are less flies around here than you'd expect. Are there less flies in the Mara, or is it perhaps because it's a fresh kill? Ravi, I think that it's a... I think it's because of the weather, largely. I think it's quite cool at the moment. The wind is blowing, which means the flies are generally fairly inactive. And so I think that's why you find that there are no flies here. There were some. You saw the lioness initially trying to snap at some of them. So that's quite an interesting theory I now have, having just remembered that, because I don't see how otherwise it would have been disemboweled like that and why they'd be struggling like they are to get in there. I had forgotten completely that Wilson from Angama Mara had explained that he'd seen a zebra around here that had clearly been attacked by a crocodile at some stage. So that's what we have here, I think. Which would explain, I'll tell you what else would it explain, while that ridiculous lioness holds the head up. It would explain, and that's because she's young, I think, that she's playing like this. It would explain why the eye is missing, and I'm pretty sure that vulture lurking on the tree that we showed you earlier is responsible for removing the eye. I think it might also explain why the wildebeest and the zebra are still here. They're now starting to move. Look at the lions. They're interested here. Go on. Have a fresh wildebeest. It's much nicer. You can take some credit for getting your own supper, chaps. Lions, of course, the ultimate scavengers. You may think that a hyena is, but lions are just as adept at scavenging as hyenas are, especially male lions. So this is I don't think it's the first time they've been at this carcass, because certainly the lioness that we first saw seemed to have blood on her chin. But it would also explain why they just kind of left it, and I think it would also explain the swelling in the belly there. Who knows? I'll tell you what else my theory is, or why, what else supports this, is that the fact that the bottom there under the tail, can you see that, Jandre, has been eaten away. but almost kind of in a half-hearted fashion. That doesn't look like a lion bite to me. That looks like a vulture's tried to get in there. That's not where lions normally eat from. They normally eat from the belly. Okay, I think the mystery of the zebra has now been solved. Ooh, there's a snake eagle. Are you going to shoot it, Jandre? Thank you. The other day, everybody, I told Jandre to shoot a rufous-bellied heron that flew over the crossing site that where we were, and Graham got very cross. He said, you can't look at a rufous-bellied heron where there are zebra and wildebeest streaming across the river. I mean, I suppose he had a fair point, but I hadn't seen a rufous-bellied heron for some time. Now, these animals are moving off, and I don't know where they're going to go. They seem, much like the wildebeest at the crossings, to be in two minds. Should they go south or north? Donald, do you want to know what the biggest bird of prey out here is? I'm going to say, Donald, in the absence of a Cape vulture, which I don't think they get here, a leopard-faced vulture would be the largest bird of prey that we find in this area. Probably about 7, 8 or 9 kilos, perhaps, which is a very big flying bird. Not quite the size of an Andean condor, but pretty close to it. Now these zebras are coming closer and closer. I'm just going to get down off my perch and stand. You may also be able to hear the gentle revving of an engine. That is somebody who is now stuck in for a long night. We mustn't laugh at their misfortune, of course, because it would be very easy to do the same thing. All right, we're going to stay here and see what plays out here. We obviously do want to have some kind of a hunting sequence this evening. So we'll decide whether we're going to stay with this lot and the wildebeest that are now streaming past them, or if we're going to go back towards the Kitchwatembo Pride. In the meantime, while we make up our minds, let's head across to Brent Leo Smith, who is on Cheetah Plains with his own wildebeest.
Of course, James is going to be incredibly jealous because we have one plus 10 wildebeest. So we've got more than that. We've got 19 wildebeest. And we've got a massive herd here in the Sarvi Sands. Not quite like the 1.5 million that James is with in the Mara Triangle. And they're out here, and he's moved off now. But Gnormalus is amongst them somewhere. I can't see him just yet. I think he's moved off down to the left. Gnormalus gnomon the gnu, of course, the dominant male wildebeest in this part of Cheetah Plains. Now, I heard the report about vultures around here earlier. I can't see one. So we're going to keep checking. We leave our wildebeest enjoying the lush, short, green grass of Cheetah Plains. And the radio has been very quiet on this side of the world today. And that's sometimes the best, because who knows what we might find. Oh, as I say that, someone starts talking. Oh no, they're just saying how little they've found. Now, apparently there were vultures on this boundary somewhere. I've already checked this section of the boundary. We just saw this lovely scene of these wildebeest here, so we came across. Now, if you've looked at our wildebeest here, and you've looked at James's wildebeest in Kenya, who can tell me what obvious differences there are between the two wildebeest? And they're actually physical differences as such, but coloration almost. So have a look. There's two very important things that are very different. So if you know what are those two things are that separate our wildebeest from James's wildebeest, let us know by hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Or you can send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. So we're looking for vultures in the trees. Apparently there are lots of vultures along the boundary here. Now they could have
had a false sighting. Maybe plummeted down and found a vulture drinking. That happens. But I can't see any others. Well, maybe as we head a bit further to the west, we might have a little bit of a change of luck. But this is today I've seen more impala on cheetah plains than I've ever seen before. Just all over the place. There are big herds of impala. There's another one. That's probably about the sixth herd of impala we've seen today. There we go. A lovely late afternoon light there. Oh, they're looking a little bit. What are they looking at? Nah, there's that one female. There we go, there she is. She looked like she was zoning in on something, but it doesn't look like it anymore. Go ahead. The lapwing. Oh, I'm nothing for us at this side yet. Well, it's where is it? I've kept it, and there it is, and there's the flower we started with. Well done to Judy Edge. It is indeed a russet bush willow flower. Now, there should be some very cool flowers up there. You can see we're heading west and towards the setting sun. Now, quite interestingly, where James is very close to the equator. So his days in comparison to ours, oh, there goes a steenbok across the road at high speed. His days in comparison to ours will be very similar. So there isn't a lot of movement in the time of sunrise and sunset. So the further you get away from the equator, the longer the gaps being. That's why at the poles you get those 24-hour days of sunlight. Any sign of those vultures? Well done. Seems like everyone's quite on it today. Indeed, the wildebeest in Kenya have white beards and white tails. The same numbers. Now, I haven't seen Mr. Quarantine in quite a long time. Now, Magnolia is wondering whether they're a different species. There's a bit of an argument about that, but not necessarily. So, if they happen to meet and mate, they'd be able to produce a viable offspring, which means they're not a different species. It's just a different color variation. Now, there are quite a few different color variations in wildebeest throughout Africa. My personal favorite, and if you remind me tomorrow, I will show you a picture, is the Nyasa wildebeest. So it's slightly paler than both the ones that James has got up there and we've got down here. And they have a white chevron like the kudu and inyala across their nose. It's actually really, really beautiful. And that's my favorite type of wildebeest out of all the different. Now, a black wildebeest is a different species, and they occur further to the south of us, high veld, in the high veld grasses. I don't see any vultures here. I'm gonna go back towards 300 road pad. Maybe Mr. Q has decided to come for a visit to say hello. Okay, so, well, with so much water around, 300 pounds, probably not quite as important as it was 2 weeks ago, but it is still on the roots of quite a few of the animals, so they will habitually walk through these areas. So always a good place to check. Now, another animal that habitually uses this area is this male cheetah, and they'll quite often walk through this and head north. But again, no sign of that. All we've found is another human being, also in search of creatures. Hi, Mvo.
How are you?
Good, thanks. One in law of CP Open and wildebeest, that's it.
There's more there south of Prison Open.
Okay.
Mala Mala. Okay. One in Yari there. Here they said on east west. It was Dingana cross to
Vuyas, yeah, I think Jamie's going there now.
Okay.
Yeah. That's too kashan for me to race. Kashan.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll also stay with that in Dovo. Okay. There's a few of them there.
Okay, cool. Thanks very much. Enjoy. There we go. Some more elephants up ahead. How exciting. And you might have heard that Tingana has apparently crossed into Juma. So I'm still a long way away. Jamie is going to try to get there. And there is a single buffalo. Zoom in. Goodbye, Mr. Buffalo. Where were those elephants? The rain is full, the water quite nice, but there's water all over the place, all the little butterfly safaris again, and wildflowers and butterflies. Now, we are looking for these elephants. Now, we the people is wondering, why don't we start a tree planting program in the Sahi sands before it becomes bare from the elephants? Well, firstly, we don't need one. There's still lots of trees. So even though they look dead, they're not. As soon as it rains, it's just... Now, elephants planting down trees are actually very good for the environment. It creates a lot of nutrients passing through back into the soil, mostly through a lot of it through termites breaking down that. So we don't need to start a tree planting program. And what happens is it goes through cycles. The trees have a good few years, which they have had for the last 10 years. It's been a very wet cycle till this year. And so the trees have actually taken over and the grasses struggled. Now, grass is actually better for carrying lots of animals. It's far more nutrient rich.
There's a pretty flower that I was looking for.
And the other thing is that every single new little tree you plant, the elephants would pull out. And wouldn't work. Look at that. Here we go.
Long-tailed cassia. And those bright yellow flowers. Now, soon they're going to be attracting hordes of beetles and wasps and bees and butterflies. They're still not all open yet, but as they open and as we get deeper into the summer, there's going to be huge amounts of insects that utilize these trees. Okay, isn't that just beautiful? Look at that. A lovely late afternoon light. It is, we are getting towards that magic hour. Sorry, just need to be on the game drive radio for a second. Jamie. Jamie, what's your position? Okay, copy, thanks. So I'm just checking where all that stuff is happening. There's a lot of movement now back towards Juma. So I think I'm going to start making my way back there. Hopefully we can have two big cats in the darkest dark night. Now this is it's just amazing everywhere I look. And there's just little bits of water. Our pitchy wine is wondering if we're going to do some frogging tonight. Certainly we shall. Hopefully we'll be able to find lots of frogs. But let us go across to Jamie, who's got a far more exciting thing to show you than the road in front of me.
This is so awesome. We've just got a report that Tingana and Shadow that have been mating over the last few days. Here's Tingana. We're going to stick with him. Rickson's got Shadow just a little bit to the south of us. And there we go. A magnificent male leopard. Hey, deja vu, Dave. This is very close to where we saw Tingana being chased up the marula tree by a lioness not too long ago. And finally, some spots on screen. It feels like it's been a really long time since we have had a leopard sighting. And he was calling just a few moments ago. I'm hoping he's going to do it again. That deep rasping, sawing sound that leopards make, both females and males. Shame boy, you looking hungry. Has Shadow been keeping you busy? Awesome. All right, everybody, hold on to your hats. Off we go. Why always into this block, leopards? Why? The trickiest spots in the world. Okie dokie. Let's do this. Just passed a civilian car, so a group of tourists just arriving to get to their lodge. You should have seen the expressions on their faces. They were so excited. Imagine coming into your lodge and you've already seen two leopards just on the way there. What an extraordinary feeling that must be. Ah, this is exciting prospects for this evening. Tingana's hungry, he's going to be hunting. We've got infrared so we don't have to leave him. This is going to be fantastic. No, this way. Go this way, mister. Please. That way is where Simbambili is. I'd prefer it if you didn't go that way. Now, I had to make a decision because there were other vehicles involved, so we've decided to stay with Tingana, but I'll keep you updated as to what Shadow is going to do, and hopefully we'll be able to get her on screen as well. Although I'm surprised she's not following him. Perhaps they've just finished off their mating. Oh, perfect. Thank you, Mr. T. Sorry, I know there's a lion called Mr. T, or was a lion called Mr. T as well. Awesome. What's he found there? Is he eating some grass or something? Do you know, I think it might actually be that marula tree. I think it was that marula tree that the lioness chased him up into the last time we saw him. How incredible is that? What a lucky coincidence. I'm pretty certain it was. Amazing. Come on, Tingana. At some point, I would really like it if you would soar for us again. I heard him when I was waiting for my chance to come into the sighting off Gowri Main. I could hear him going, absolutely awesome. Look at that scratch across his nose. That wasn't there last time, was it? I think that must have been courtesy of a shadow, perhaps. Did he have that scratch the last time? I can't remember. Don't remember seeing it. No, I think that's new. Ah, the trials and tribulations of being a dominant male leopard. I don't know what he's licking, but it's obviously a really nice smell because now he's rubbing his face in it. Oh, wow. Here we go. Now we have a chance to have an extraordinary sighting. There is nothing more beautiful than a leopard in the afternoon sunlight. Except maybe a lion. No, leopards are, I don't know. Difficult to decide. He is on the move, he is hungry. Oh yes, scent marking. Perhaps he'll call. So for our new viewers, and I know there are quite a few new viewers, I'd like to introduce you to Tingana, who is the dominant male leopard of most of our area. Okay, right. Again, everybody grab onto your hats and your stools or whatever, and off we go. The arms of your armchair, perhaps, your office chair, your couch. Don't disappear. Please don't go west, boy. Now, don't forget that this is happening live here in the Sabi Sands. My name is Jamie. This afternoon, Dave is sitting behind me on camera, bringing you the amazing images of that beautiful male leopard. And it's all coming to you live. And because it's live, it means it's interactive, which means send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Or email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Thanks, yours. Don't go, Mr. T. Please don't go. Oh, well, that's okay if he does. We've still got Shadow. Hopefully deciding to stay on our side of the boundary. Around the monkey orange we go. For our new viewers watching us drive over trees, just so that you don't get too concerned, we are very, very careful about where we drive. It is the same tree because here's my vehicle tracks. We're very careful about which species of trees we drive over. We choose the young, resilient ones that pop right back up. And I promise you, they really do pop right back up. I'm gonna have to reposition. I know we've got a beautiful shot, but yours is doesn't have a view, and that's not very fair, is it? Oh no, don't go that way, boy. Whoopsie, that's embarrassing. That was quite the sting. I'm hoping he's gonna go up onto that termite mound. It might give him a slightly better vantage point. Oh, I've done this before. Oh no, here comes the monkey orange, Dave. Luckily we don't have a very sensitive piece of equipment on the front of the vehicle. I'm going to pull over and I'm going to let yours go ahead of me for a little bit. As soon as he gets round, look at this. I'm also hoping that if we give him a little bit of space, he might decide to stay on this side of our property. There he goes. A male leopard in his prime. Go for it. Never. Sorry, just having a quick chat to yours. Okay. Off we go. I think I actually see a clearer path through here after all that. Isn't it? Sorry everybody, I'm just concentrating. Okay, no problem, I'm just going to, there we go. There he goes, straight towards the Gowrie repeater. I'm so hoping that he does call for us. Now, Blair, you wanted to know why the leopard has so much excess skin hanging from his belly. And the answer is he's not in bad condition, but he's hungry. So that flap is only visible when a big cat, you'll see it on lions as well, when a big cat is particularly hungry. So that's why when he has a full belly, then that excess skin is basically, the leopard will gorge himself on the big meal and that excess skin will disappear as he gets, looks a little bit like he has swallowed a beach ball. Okay, let's catch up with him. The reason he is so thin is because of matters of the heart, or at least instinct. So he's been mating with a female over the last few hours. Days, sorry, not hours, days. And during that time, the leopards will not eat, they will not hunt, they just are focused on each other. And as a result, both of them will be looking particularly hungry. I've just heard that Shadow's crossed back onto Arethusa. Sorry, Dave, here we go. Where's he gone? Got him. Oh, little Steenbokkie. You have no idea how lucky you were. Little antelope just dashed out in front of us. He has no idea how close that leopard came. Or maybe he does. I've lost him again. Oh, there he is. He's spotted something. It's just... Oh, no, he stopped. I thought for a second he was going to go hunting. Come on, Tingana. Up onto the termite mound we go. Could see how perfectly relaxed he is. And up towards the termite mound. Okay. Once again, off we go through the monkey orange. And away. We okay there, Dave? Good. Now, Tasha, Michelle, you wanted to know, while we're talking about our hungry leopard, how often leopards have to eat. And the answer is roughly once every 3 days, but it depends on what they eat and the meal that they get. So they can go, got it? Cool. They can go for quite an extended period of time without eating, as Tingana probably has. He doesn't look as though he's eaten in at least a week. What's he looking at? So stop for a second. Very, very careful to make sure that we watch the animal's body language constantly. And if there's a point at which the animal goes into hunting mode, then it's very, very important that we give it the space and the quiet that it needs. But for now, he's just walking. And clearly we've arrived just at the end of Shadow and Tingana's current mating period. And unfortunately, the sad news in this situation is it's not looking good for poor Shadow's cub. So we didn't really have confirmation. We knew that she was mating again. She had a very, very young cub, a 6-month-old leopard cub, when she was mating with Tingana. And we don't know what it is. We don't know if she lost the cub to some other threat and then started mating again, or if there is actually something in Shadow's biology that brings her back into estrus far sooner than she should normally, with the result being that she has to instinctively go and mate with a male and leave her cub. And her cub at 6 months old would not have been old enough to take care of itself and to feed itself. Now, Laura, you were wondering, it's a very interesting question, you wanted to know if perhaps the male leopards force females into estrus and therefore result in the loss of her cubs and forces her to mate with them, and that you'd read something to that effect about the lions and the Mara. I've never heard of that. Okay, I'm going to reposition. Laura, I personally haven't read up on that. I'm going to have to go and do some research. I don't think so, no, because if that were the case, they would do it to other females, like Karula as well. But they don't. So I would suggest not, but I'm very interested and very keen to read a little bit more about that process in the Mara itself. And I'm not looking at you, sorry, I've got to concentrate on getting through here. Laura, it's interesting because, of course, we know that the male big cats will often kill cubs not sired by themselves to bring the female back into estrus. Oh dear, I've trapped myself. Oh goodness. I'm going to make sure I don't lose him. Nobody else is here anymore. There he is. I'm also giving him plenty of space so that I can watch his body language as he moves through, because he's clearly hungry. So Laura, I'd be really keen, and I'd be very grateful actually, if you could point me in the right direction as to where you found that information, because it sounds very, very interesting, and it's not something I've ever heard of, apart from the males killing the cubs that are not theirs to bring the females back into estrus. And that does happen with male leopards as well. And in fact, there's statistics that suggest that about at least 50% of cub deaths before a year old are caused by male leopards. I'll try and get Dave a good view as he pops out here. Here he goes. Awesome. Okay, ready? Let's go. Now, Michael, you were wondering. Go ahead, Rex. He's just gone through there. Straight there. You'll see him now. Just through there.
Thank you.
No problem. Sorry. Michael, interesting question from you, and that is whether or not the fact that a shadow was fathered by her grandfather would have something to do with her peculiar estrus cycles, since you know that there is a certain resilience to leopard inbreeding, but you're wondering if that might have played a role. Well, the truth is, Michael, we don't actually know that Shadow was fathered by her grandfather. It's a possibility. Karula was seen mating with her father, which does happen. I've lost him. Where is he gone? Sorry, everybody. Just hold on one moment. I think Rex has still got him. Let me just check. Rex, have you got visual there? I have no idea what he just said. It may have been yes, it may have been no. Okay, so Michael, as we've said before, we don't know with leopards and their paternity. Sorry, everybody, I'm just concentrating on getting us through this without damaging the VR rig as well. Sure. Okay. I cannot see him in this dense vegetation. There he is. Okay, we're gonna get him. He's gonna walk straight in front of the vehicle. There we go. Ah, imagine being those guests on that vehicle and what that experience must be like. So incredibly exciting. Okay, we're gonna stick with Tingana as much as possible. Let's head back across to James, who is in the Mara with some very tired lions.
There we are, everybody. We've turned to infrared. Night is falling here in the Mara Triangle. The zebra that these two have thought about eating, they have now forsaken. I don't know why, but they have been giving a very good look towards the wildebeest that have moved off to the sort of western side of where we're now sitting. Whether they will move and try and hunt them, I don't know. But we're going to sit with them. The Kichwa Pride seems to be very much flat cat, as it were. They're very full. Don't know what they've eaten. Just hearing now that apparently they're quite good buffalo specialists, which is interesting. So they could have a vulture. No, I actually don't believe I just said that. They could have a buffalo in the drainage line where we lost them yesterday. Not a vulture. They're not vulture specialists, everyone. They are buffalo specialists. And I think that's quite a good theory, because apparently all Peter could see was the fact that whatever animal they'd killed had a very large, a very large rib cage.
James?
Yes, Graham.
Directly in front of us, a lion is emerging.
A lion is emerging from directly in front of us. Graham is a very, very talented, because he can tell
that that one pixel you can see there on your screen is a lion. Much as I'd love to say, don't be ridiculous, at this stage I think I actually might concur with him. That will make it twice in one day that we have had a concurrence.
Which is scary. What does it mean?
It's frightening. I don't know that it's healthy. I also cannot see anything with my binoculars. It is an invisible lion, giving only a heat signature. Rather like that rather dreadful movie, Predator.
The heat signature's also been drastically reduced.
Well, that will normally happen if it goes behind a bush, I imagine. Graham says the heat signature has been drastically reduced by it going behind a bush. I can hear some bats going. What do you think, Graham? You want to go and look? It's somewhere around those two trees there, everybody, that you can see there.
It's moving slightly east.
It's moving east now. I think to the left of that, Jandri.
I think it's coming towards us.
Go to the left of that, left of the tree on the left of that. Yeah, if you zoom in there, that's where I believe
there,
it to be.
Right of that.
Hey?
Of where Jandri is looking.
Yes.
To the right of that.
Sorry, Jandre, it's to the right of the vulture tree.
Yeah.
Oh, I see, okay.
Right,
I'm with you now. So, it's very difficult to tell what on earth our fearless leader is pointing his thermal camera at because he's in the back of the car. It's a very big thing coming towards us. It is a very big and completely invisible thing coming towards us. Ah, there it is. You might want to pan left.
Not that bird.
Not that bird, no. Those things of which we do not speak. Jandre?
Yeah.
Oh. Now, for when many of you on Safari Live, you will know that there are certain things of which we do not speak. And that was one of them. So if you're wondering, everyone, we have a policy of not showing rhinoceros on Safari Live. That is because of the poaching scourge. It's largely in South Africa, not so much up here. But we're not going to show rhino. And rather than play that we don't know what that was, it was a rhino going down into the woodland there. Now, Remy, you say, is this typical activity of the big cats, and you're a new viewer. Remy, I'm just going to give you a quick update as to what we think happened here. This is not typical behavior, but this is a migration season. In fact, so between July and October in this area, there are a huge number of animals that aren't here for the rest of the year. Large numbers of wildebeest, zebra, Thompson's gazelles, and eland. Now, we don't think that this zebra was killed by these lions. We think it was killed, well, eventually by a crocodile. So you can see its guts are hanging out there. That is unusual. And what we think happened is that it was grabbed by a crocodile, broke the skin. It came wandering up here and eventually died on its own. The reason we think that is that the eye is missing. There was a vulture sitting nearby and that clearly some evidence of a vulture trying to get in to the flesh through the bottom. And that these cats are lying next to it is, I don't know if it's typical for this area, but I'm going to say that when there is a during migration season, when there is such a massive amount of food in this area, I'm going to say that to call anything typical behavior would be a mistake. I think these cats might eat the zebra. They may go hunting later. We think there could be a male lion, three male lions around here somewhere. That's what Graham is searching for with the thermal imaging camera now. So, I mean, they don't look like they've fed recently because they're not full. They would definitely have fed sometime in the last week or so. Well, probably in the last few days because there's so much for them to eat at the moment. So the fact that they're lying down next to an imminently eatable carcass, well, I'm going to say it's quite strange, but perhaps for migration season it isn't. I'm also going to say to you that I wonder if the zebra didn't die of an infection, as well as having its guts sort of hanging out there. And the reason I say that is that if a crocodile and its foul, rotten, flesh-bespattered teeth got into the guts of that zebra, you can almost be certain that it would be infected with some horrendous bacteria. So when it came down here and flopped down dead, you might find that the flesh is so infected that these lions are put off it. Now that's not, I mean, lions will eat very rotten flesh, but you might find that this is just a little bit, I don't know, maybe there's something in there that they don't like. They've had a bit of a go at the ear there, you can see. Alright, we're going to sit here, not a particularly pretty picture at this stage. We're going to figure out what these lions are doing. We may move on to the Kitrotembo Pride at some stage, but in the meantime, let's go across and see how our old pal, the great prince of Juma, Tingana, is doing.
A little bit hungry, but otherwise the prince is in very good condition. He's been slowly sneaking forward, and it makes me wonder if he doesn't know something we don't. Right now he is surrounded by a collection of old aardvark burrows, which means that this is as close as we can get for now without risking our vehicle going tumbling in. But Tingana certainly has a reputation as something of a burrowing creature hunter. When I first arrived, I was told that he often hunted aardvark. And at least twice we've seen him, no, three times we've seen him on a warthog kill. Once with Peter Pretorius, where he actively went into the burrow itself whilst live and pulled out a piglet. So he doesn't have any concerns. He's clearly not a claustrophobic leopard. He certainly has no concerns about diving underneath the surface of the soil. So perhaps he's patiently waiting here at these burrows. Maybe he knows something we don't. Although I certainly hope that the first aardvark I see live is not in the jaws of Tingana. That would be a bit devastating. We'll have to wait and see. And Tingana apparently has a reputation for being very, very good at playing the patience game. Just waiting for the opportunity to pounce on something when it exits its burrow. The brilliant thing about this, of course, is that we will be able to sit here in infrared light as it starts to get dark, and perhaps something like an aardvark will pop out of this burrow. He certainly snuck forward very, very carefully, and I wonder if that's not been in his plan all along. Perhaps he very deliberately came to this particular spot. He went quiet, he stopped calling, and when he snuck forward here, he walked very lightly. Almost like he was afraid to tread too heavily upon the ground, and perhaps warn whatever creatures are hidden here of his arrival. He's definitely starving. He's very, very hungry. We've got a lunchbox, Tingana, but I don't think we could give it to you, unfortunately. I'm only joking. We don't ever feed our animals, our wild animals. And I think Dave would be terribly upset with me if I gave him my Dave's sandwich. Hello to Michelle, who has just joined us and is 12.